America, we are going to shift, and I am going to release the keyboard player. Thank you so much. What's your name? Sheila? Shanna? S-H-E-E-N-A? N-E-A? Double letter is Shanna. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for hanging on there and being so patient. Ramagaya Sikata. And Father God, increase her anointing. And bless her, O Lord, immensely, abundantly, extravagantly, supernaturally. O Ramagaya Sikata, in every direction, north, east, west, south. And the blessing of beauty that is desired by every lady to break out from you in Jesus' name. Glory to God. Don't you know you can be a man and still be beautiful? Actually, the Bible describes God as beautiful. God is not being described as handsome in the Bible. It is beauty, because beauty has nothing to do with your gender. It speaks of your spirit. So a lot of the description is describing who you are or whose you are in your spirits. Not really according to your gender. In the same manner, when the Bible said, you are my son, and the Lord can say that to a lady, and God is trying to make you a man, but a sonship has nothing to do with gender. It speaks about your position in the eyes of God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. So, good evening, Bacolod City, Philippines. Amen. Welcome to the Intercessors Regional Summits. We are on our fourth session, and I believe you have learned a lot already since yesterday. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Okay, let's give God a hand of praise. There is no famine of the word in Bacolod City. Glory to God. The worst thing that can happen to a city, if there is a famine of the word, you're hungry and there is no one who is feeding you. But I'm telling you what, there will be a manifesting until Friday and even until Saturday to those who would follow us in Victoria City for a day. Ramayasikata. Thank you, Lord. Ramagayasikata. So many cities of the Philippines are dreaming of our visits. You are one of those fortunate cities that God has chosen to be visited for a season. It doesn't mean it's gonna be like this all the time. So that's why you need to learn what you need to learn, because all of these visits are only for a season. You can be visited frequently only for a season until the Spirit of God is going to shift the direction of the ministry to another city, to another nation, and to another, you know, group of people. But at this season, we are here in this region because there is a purpose for it. In fact, I can already feel that starting next year, I don't think we are going to visit Philippines as frequently or as we did in the last 3 years. I'm already sensing it in my spirit that America already needs me. And I think I will be traveling more in North America, among the Americas, than in Asia. And I can already feel it coming. So you need to learn everything that you need to learn. Sharabagaya Sikata. Saul is not here. You know, when I said it to Saul, and she said, I am going now to prospect for my next speaker. That I am going to create an event. You know, the mind of an event organizer. And I said, I think you should do that. Because I believe that starting next year, I don't think that, you know, that I think the Lord is now going to reduce our visits to so many nations. But I can see the Americas, that would include North, South America, Central America, and even part of Europe, will get the biggest chunk of our visit already. And I believe I have poured so much already to the Philippines in the last 3 years. However, if the Lord wants me to insert a few cities, I will do it for a season. But I can see it right now that a lot of those major metropolitan cities of our calling is already waiting for our visits, and that is going to become our priority starting next year. Glory to God. So you know, you step into those doors while they're open, because not all the time they are open. And then you're going to keep on banging your head to those doors that will not open for you. You're going to have to wait for the timing and the season of God. And also you need to understand that not all doors are for you. That's why sometimes people get frustrated because they're trying to press themselves so hard for an opportunity that they thought it's their blessing, but actually it's not their door. And you know what happened? It destroyed them. They develop a bad reputation in the eyes of men because they thought it's their blessing. But what they do not realize, it is not their door. And above all, it is not their season for it to be open to them. I am now seeing nations of the world that are opening their doors for us that 3 years ago will not open their door. And I have since seen cities and churches that would like to invite us to their churches that 3 years ago, they will not do it. But when I look at and review what they have, they already missed their opportunity. We could never step in into their churches. Not all doors are for us. We choose the door that we would like to enter in. And we also choose our battles. You have the right to choose. But if you don't know it, you just blow and blow. Ramagaya sikata. And a lot of ministers in the body of Christ, you need to understand the principle of seasons and open doors. And so many are not seeing success and fruit in their ministry because they do not know how God works in season and how God works in doors. However, if you understand these things, you could never become unfruitful in the work of the Lord. You will always become effective in whatever place that God will give you. The way God opens the door for us, it's so supernatural. This ministry is surrounded with so much favor, unbelievable. I did not ask for it, I did not beg for it, I did not even dream for it. But the Lord just surrounded the ministry with so much favor that I'm telling you, we don't sweat, we don't worry about where to get the money to travel, where to pay for our hotel. When God says it's your door, all of the finances line up and is there. That's when you know it, that God has called you for a purpose. When you see that the funds are drying up, you know it, it's no longer your door. But if you still keep on blowing it, it's like walking in the middle of the wilderness when God wants to cross you to a sea somewhere. But this is where you need to understand the ways of God. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Everybody say, you are going to be blessed tonight. Turn around and tell the neighbor on the left, you are going to be blessed tonight. Hallelujah. Were you already blessed in the last 3 sessions? Were you blessed already?
Yes.
Praise God. All right. Sometimes I'm trying to avoid to not to scream on you too hard because if I'm high pitch, you are straining your mind to understand. But when my voice is too low, you can fall asleep. So we need to have a good balance between being a high pitch and moderating our voice in a baritone level in order for you to be here, because you can be physically here but your spirit is already dreaming somewhere. So we need you to be here, mind, body, and spirit. Praise God. And you know what it is, people, that just like you a long time ago, I was also sitting in the preaching messages of other men and women of faith. And I just love to hear the voices of men and women of faith. And I just store everything in my spirit. Do I understand all of them? Absolutely not. Do I need all of them? Absolutely not. Do I find myself in their illustration most of the time? Absolutely not. But what I did not realize, if I have deposited something in my spirit, I can withdraw something when the opportunity would arise. But if you are not exposed and you have no storage inside of you, and if you need it, you are groping in the dark to find a solution, when the purpose of God is to store it inside your spirit so that when you need wisdom, insight, and understanding, in order to solve a problem, all that you have to do is draw from which is inside of you. If there is nothing stored inside of you, nothing will come out from you. The beauty of the overflow coming out of your mouth is because you have a beautiful belly. Look at the belly. Is it beautiful? A beautiful belly stores a lot of the knowledge of God. You store a lot of that anointing inside of you. You store a lot of fire there. You store a lot of faith there. You store a lot of wisdom there, of revelation there. So look at your belly and talk to your belly. How are you today? Are you full? Are you famished? Are you overflowing? Who has a beautiful belly among you? The best preacher is the one who has a beautiful belly. Oh, Ramagaya Sika, not the one who has a good message. You can have a good one-time message, but you don't have a message every day. But someone who has a beautiful belly will have a good message every day, not only every Christmas or Holy Week. You have a good message every day. Why? Your belly is full. So how's your belly? Your belly is doing good? Oh my Lord, for the next 4 sessions and 5 sessions left, we are going to fill up your belly. I want your burp not only in the physical, but I want you to be burping in your spirit because your belly is full. Yes. Glory to God. Yes. Praise the Lord. We are gonna make a competition of the most beautiful belly. Not the one is 24 inches, nor 25 inches. It's a beautiful belly in the spirits. Okay? If there is empty talking, because the belly is empty. If there is a cursing, because it's full of cursing here. But I'm telling you what, fill it up with the knowledge of God and with the anointing, and you will see it. The overflow of your belly are words that will edify those who hear you. Praise God. Amen. You know what is the secret to be beautiful? Fill up your belly. Fill up your belly. That's the secret of beauty. It's true either you are a male or a female. That's why God is beautiful. Because every time God will open his mouth, there is always something new that you can learn and receive from the Lord. It is very exhausting and depleting to be around with people who say a lot, but they say nothing. Don't you know that you can talk so much that after hearing from you, I don't hear anything? Because you haven't really talked anything, but you have spoken a lot already. That's why the beauty of your overflow is dependent on the beauty of your belly. Alright, so look at your belly. Some of the belly, there are mounds. Some of them are flats. Some of them are six-pack. Because you're very good in bodybuilding. But I'm telling you what, I'm not talking of the physical. I'm talking of your belly in the spirits. Okay, tell your neighbor, watch your belly. Oh, glory to God. Oh, Ramagaya Sikata, Rabagaya Sikata. Praise the Lord. All right, I would like to request our projectionists to project the message for tonight. The title is The Parallel. Hallelujah. The message tonight is about the parallel of the nation Israel and another nation. Guess what? It's the Philippines. I am going to show to you that there are parallel prophetic destinies between Israel and the Philippines. When you hear the word parallel, meaning this, they have the same. There are certain level of similarity between the two of them that you can compare side by side, and you can see an identical manifestation of the work of the Spirit in these two countries. You are going to understand on how God deals with Israel and how God is dealing with the Philippines. is no separate from what God deals with Israel. And also, I have been speaking in the United States, and I have been speaking also in Singapore. And I have noticed that the destiny of America and Singapore are also parallel. It is amazing that God can raise up nations that have two parallel destinies. Everybody say with me, parallel. When you hear the word parallel, it's two lines meeting in the same path that it is going to end somewhere. And I do not see why the destiny of the Philippines is not going to end like the way it was with Israel. And I can also see that the destiny of Singapore is going to become like America, but Singapore has a chance to create their own destiny by learning the errors of other nations. Sometimes what is said is this: if you are the forerunner, meaning there is no one ahead of you, you can be a forerunner nation. You are so ahead in technology. You are so ahead when it comes to economy. You are so ahead when it comes to the breakout of so many industries, and other nations are only following you. That's because of the United States. But you see, if you are following a forerunner, you have something to look up to. But if you are the forerunner, you have no one on top of you to follow. You only have God to look up to. So at the end of the day, the follower of the forerunners would be better, because you have God's, plus you have another one on top of you that you can look up to, and you can follow the good things that they do and avoid their mistakes. Right now, America is the forerunner among the nations of the world. Their technologies are being counterfeited by China. Philippines had copied the constitution of United States. Even a portion of the constitution of Singapore was taken from the constitution of the United States. Why? She is a forerunner. So where did United States get her constitution? United States gets her constitution from the Bible. You see, people, if you do not know what to do, if you are running a business, or you are planning to get married and raise up a family, you need to establish the foundation of your life and the foundation of your marriage and your household to the Word of God. Because if you do, God will honor and bless you. You are not perfect, but once you follow the Word of God, you are coming close to a step of excellence. And you need to understand this: no one knows everything in one night, in one day, or in 2 days, or in 2 weeks. And a lot of you are impatient of where you are now in life. But I would like to tell you this, that our walk and our relationship with God is not something like you just put something in the microwave and put 1 minute in order to heat a popcorn, and 1 minute the popcorn is done. It's not like that in our walk with God. You need to stay with God, learn from God, understand the Word of God, and get this. It doesn't mean that you know the Word of God, you know the ways of God. No. The ways of God, you are going to learn it as you mature. Okay? You can know the Word of God today. You can even memorize the entire book of John chapter 3. But it doesn't mean you know the ways of God. The ways of God is known over time. And your constant knowing of the Word of God will eventually bring you to the knowledge of the ways of God. And the ways of God is what mature people. I want you to understand this. Doctrine is good. However, doctrine is foundational. Say that with me. Doctrine is foundational. When a doctrine is being taught to you about the doctrine of salvation, the doctrine of the second coming, the doctrine of the eschatology, the doctrine of hell, the doctrine of angels, they are foundational. But you need more than doctrine in order to survive life. If you keep on feeding people doctrine without teaching them how to survive life, survive crisis, even though the doctrine is God's, I am telling you, it is not enough to sustain people's faith. Eventually, you will lose the people that sit at the pew. It's not because you are bad as a preacher. You are not just balanced.
Yes.
Glory to God. We preach message that you need, and we also preach message that you don't need now. But we need to preach it in order to prepare you to a place of balance in the spirit, so that when you face a crisis, you knew it, you have heard it somewhere, and you have the capacity to know what to do, and the message that was preached will give you the ability to overcome. Glory to God. I don't only preach subject that I am comfortable or happy with. I preach subject, even those subjects that are difficult to preach, and we are studying it, that it will come out easy so that you will understand it. That's why in the Word of God, it teaches us to honor those who break the Word of God and those who spend their time in praying, because reading the Bible is good. However, to create an excellent message for you, you need to study the Word of God. And get this, people, 45 minutes of preaching is equivalent to 8 hours of work. 45 minutes of preaching is already equivalent for 8 hours of work for most of you. And if you preach 2 sessions in a day, like in a conference, and I preach between 90 minutes to 75 to 90 minutes, meaning because it's 2 sessions in a day, I already worked for 2 days. Plus it's more than 45 minutes, I worked for 4 days. That's why I'm tired. And I did not know that. And you need to possess that supernatural ability to finish what you need to finish, because time is so little and there is so much more that needs to be taught to the body of Christ. Glory to God. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's go to the next PowerPoint slides. I want you to understand on how God relates to the nation. Number one point that you need to understand tonight is that God established nations and defines their boundaries. Say with me, boundaries. When God created a nation, and because we are here in the Philippines, the Lord already decided in His mind that Philippines is going to have 7,107 islands during low tides, and less than that during high tides. And some of those islands are not closely in the Philippines, but some of them are outside the Philippines. But nonetheless, God already established boundaries for the nations. In the book of Acts chapter 17, verse 26, the Word of God said, "And He made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and the boundaries of their habitation." Everybody say with me, appointed time.
Appointed time.
The Lord knows when a nation is going to start and when a nation is going to end.
Amen.
So, not only the person has a beginning, that's the time when you were conceived in your mother's womb, and then you end here on earth when you stop breathing. That's an appointed time. Even nations of the world, God already appointed when they are going to start and when they are going to end. Eventually, Philippines will cease to exist. Right now, the nation is here. But eventually, Philippines is going to cease to exist. Why? There is a beginning and end of everything. So while Philippines is here, continue to praise God, because God has given the Philippines a land. Okay, in order for the Filipinos and other immigrants that migrate in this nation to have a place of habitation. The problem that you see in the Middle East, right in Israel, is this. The Palestinian people that occupied Israel for more than 2,300 years is this. What is their problem? They have a culture. They have a language. They have an economy. They have a people, but they do not have a land.
Yes.
They do not have a land. That's the problem why there is a problem with the jihadists in Israel. There's a problem with the Palestinian people. Their problem there is not oil people. The problem there is, it's an issue of lands. And God says, even before Abraham was called, it was already in the mind of God to give Israel a land. When God would talk to you and say, I have a land for you, even though you don't see that land or the piece of real estate, when God talks to us like that, that's the prophetic in God. I want you to understand, people, that the prophetic ministry did not start with Eunice Bennett ministry. That the prophetic ministry did not start with the earlier prophets in the book of New Testament. The prophetic ministry started in the mind of God. When the Lord said to the Son, you show up, that's the prophetic of in God declaring that those things that do not exist shall exist. It will require a prophetic declaration and a level of faith to say that in order for those things that are not to become. And I am telling you, people, there are only few gifts of the Spirit of God. There are so many. But there are only few gifts in the Spirit of God that has the power to create. I'll mention a few. One of them is the gift of faith. That gift of faith can create something that those things that are not shall become. That gift of prophecy will also create it. If you don't speak it out in faith, nothing will be produced. And the gift of healing and the gift of the effecting of miracles are the two other gifts that has the power to create. You need to understand, people, you can be gifted in discernment. It is also needed in the body, but it does not create. You can be gifted in tongues. You pray longer and your tongues are the sound of, they're just beautiful. But tongues does not create. You can also interpret the tongues, but the interpretation could not create. There are only four gifts of the Spirit of God that the Spirit of God has given to humanity that has the power to create. You see, these people, if you don't understand that the gift of the Spirit can create, you will never fully utilize your gift. And those believers, men or women of God, that have matured in the understanding of the gift of the Holy Spirit are the ones being used by God on an international level, that they are now a blessing, not only in the area of gifts, but their understanding of the gift becomes a blessing to the body of Christ. And I'm telling you this, people, unless you will become gifted, you will never fully appreciate that you can be a blessing of God to a greater body in the whole universe. Using these people in order to do what needs to be done for the body, you need to be gifted. You need to have the Spirit of God. Otherwise, you will only become an audience every Sunday. You need to be gifted, and you could not afford not to be gifted. Because if you don't have any gifting at all, you will only watch and you will only become a spectator of the gifted. But if you have the gift, you can become more effective than where you are right now. When God had chosen Israel, one of the greatest gifts that God has given that nation is the understanding of the mystery of the mind of God that you call prophecy. You could never become a Jewish person without being prophetic. Once you came out of that blood, being prophetic is already part of you. And you need to understand that everything, okay, and when I say everything, everything comes from the Jewish faith. The word of God started with them. The promise started with them. The land started with them. Technology started with them. Civilization started with them. I told the Singaporean last May, I said, the way that God raised up Singapore in only 50 years, you are so young compared to the rest of the Asian nation, but the way God raised you up, it is very impossible for a civilization like this not being sown by a Jewish faith. I believe there is a Jewish person sitting in this nation that it become how it become. And when I say that, they started to dig up upon their parliament to find out who are the early founders of the nation. And you know what they have discovered? Their chief prime minister, someone just below the prime minister. When the nation was started, it was started with David, with Nikyuwanyu, the prime minister. And then you have the chief prime minister. And they have discovered that the chief prime minister is David Marshall, an Orthodox Jew. And David Marshall introduced the word of God at the founding of a nation. And I said to myself, what a blessed nation! David Marshall would read to them Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy in all their meetings. David Marshall shaped the minds, influenced the mind, debated Lee Kuan Yew to bring the nation back to its past. You see these people, and I said this, that's why I told you when I spoke that to them, I spoke under the inspiration of the Spirit of prophecy. I did not know the history. But when I say that, they start running to their parliament and discovered that their chief prime minister was an Orthodox Jew. It was David Marshall. That's why your civilization is like this Singaporean. You are very upright and righteous. Why? It is the Abrahamic seed that was planted as the DNA of the nation when it was founded. Nations of the world that did not start in the Abrahamic seed, it is not too late. Everything can be returned to the foundation, because the Bible said that the Gentile nations are grafted to the vine. Okay, you are the branch. Do not stand here. Okay, go here on my left. If this is the Jewish faith, if I am the Gentile nation, I am only grafted to the vine, the Jewish faith. The vine that I am talking here is small letter V. V-I-N-E, Jewish faith. And then there is a vine mentioned in John 15, the capital V, which is God the Father. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the vine mentioned in the book of Romans. That this vine is the Jewish faith. The knowledge of God, the promise of God, the civilization, it comes from here. And the Gentile nation, anyone outside of the Jewish seed, it's a Gentile. You can be an American, a European, an African, an Asian. If you don't have the Jewish blood, You are a Gentile. And the Lord said, the Gentile nation is grafted to the vine.
Yes.
How do you become a partaker of the faith? It is through your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Why? Because you are grafted in the vine. Okay? Without Jesus, the Gentile nation doesn't have the level of hope the way the Jewish people do. That's why the Jewish people, even if they don't know the Lord, they already have the promise by the virtue of God choosing Israel.
Yes.
Okay? But the Gentile nation, they need to be connected to the vine in order to become a part of Israel's blessing. Every nation of the world need to understand it, that this is the principle of God. In order to prosper a nation, you need to connect yourself to the vine, the Abrahamic faith, in order for that blessing to flow. Otherwise, the rest of what will come out of the Gentile nation are either idolatry or witchcraft. Very interesting. Don't you know that the last day's revelation of the blood moons, the Shemitah, okay, and other mysteries of God, all the revelations are coming from a Jewish prophetic voice. You know why? Because the Jewish prophetic mind is different from a Gentile mind. God blessed them with a level of understanding concerning mystery, and they easily believe it. But the Gentile nation was so into idolatry that when God gives it to them, the witchcraft and idolatry will rise up and try to squash and destroy the prophetic voice. Thank you, Lenore. When I was in Singapore, I told the Singaporean, your level of receptivity when it comes to receiving the prophetic voice is very unusual for so many Asian nations. This level of receptivity can only come from being sown and seeded by a Jewish seed. And I was so right on. They won't believe it when they have discovered from the parliaments that their chief prime minister at the founding of their nation is an Orthodox Jew. How good is your God? When the spirit of prophecy reconciled with the research, and they found out that what I am saying is very accurate, in order to tell them, hey, look, you become, because there is a destiny for a nation. Look at this. Singapore is only 50 years old, but the nations of the world are finding her as the employer. How many Filipinos are there in Singapore, either working as domestic helper or an overseas foreign worker for another career? Only 150,000 from the Philippines alone. That doesn't include other migrant workers coming from other countries like Indonesia, Malaysia. Some of them are coming from smaller countries of Burma, Taiwan, and Vietnam. Only in 50 years, they rose up. This is an evidence when God would bless a nation. Singapore is so blessed that what started them is the Jewish seed. Glory to God. And part of that startup is because the destiny of the nation of Singapore is to become a nation of refuge. Say with me, a nation of refuge.
A nation of refuge.
During the time of Moses, when Egypt was hit by a plague, there were 10 plagues, all right? And Egypt is right next to Goshen. Okay? And the Lord said, whatever plague that you will suffer in Egypt, the next neighboring nation, Goshen, will not suffer any of the plague. Why? Because God knows the boundaries. Okay? The nation, Goshen, was only right next to Egypt. It's like Israel is right next to Egypt and Syria and Lebanon. Okay? There is a boundary that separates you from another nation. During the 10 plagues that had happened during the time of Moses, get this, Goshen had never seen one of those plagues because of the boundaries. There you can see that God owned the plague. He owns the frogs. He owns the insects. That even the insects pay attention to the voice of God. When God said, you will only infest Bacolod City and spare Silai City. I am telling you, the infestation is only in Bacolod. When God will say, you know what? The fountain will only be in Cardiff City, but the rest of the cities of Negros will be preserved. I'm telling you what, all the heat will only go in that place. This is very interesting. And you know, why did God preserve Goshen? Because anyone that will be affected by the plague can run to Goshen, because the destiny of Goshen is a nation of refuge. Look at me very closely. With what is happening in Asia, okay? All Asian nations are going to suffer the shakings of God. Some of them will be earthquake. Some of them will be floods. Some of them will be tsunami. Some of them will be the case of Yolanda, a disaster of biblical proportion. And you need a nation of refuge in order to run to, because the rest of the Asian nations will suffer the judgment, the shaking, or the chastisement of God. Among the Asian nations, listen to this very closely. I researched this. In 2013, okay, there were 1,000 earthquakes that visited the world. Everybody say with me, that's a lot. 1,000 earthquakes visited the world. Out of the 1,000, only 7 was outside Asia. Out of the 1,000, think about it, only 7 were outside Asia. 993 was in Asia. This is an earthquake from 3.5 until 8.2. 993 is coming from Asia. Asia is suffering the major shaking compared to the rest of the continents of the world. How many continents do we have? We have America. We have Africa. What else, Ellie? My children knows this. You have all kinds of continents. Can you imagine this? Out of the 7 continents, the earthquake focused in Asia, 993 out of the 1,000. And out of the 993, 10 of that hit the Philippines. Philippines is not spared from the judgment and the shaking of God. And out of the 993 that hit Asia, almost all Asian nations was hit by earthquake, including Israel. There's only one nation that was untouched by the shaking. It is Singapore. Because the destiny of the nation is to become a nation of refuge. When the rest of the nations of the world are being shaken by disasters, calamity, God intends to spare a nation in order for the rest of the nation to run into it. When I prophesied that on Singapore in 2013, okay, all these regions never came back yet. And I told them, your nation will be spared by God from any disaster. And then a year later, the regions came back. Singapore was so spared by God. She never get one out of the 993. Isn't that the hand of God? Philippines got 10. Nepal was almost destroyed. Why do you think the Lord spared Singapore as a nation? Get this, zero corruption. The way God deals to a nation, God will look at the entire integrity of a nation. The more wicked the nation, the greater is a disaster that would come to a nation. We have read it this morning that because the prophets do not teach the ways of God and bring people out of a lifestyle of sin, so now God is going to send what? Hailstorm in the middle of a nation full of desert places that never have seen rain, and one day you will see a snow, not only a snow but an ice. Very interesting. Even Israel was not spared. You know why? Because not everyone that lives in Israel is Israel. Some of them are Zionists. What are those Zionists? These are people that supports and love God, who would like to support the Jewish people, and they decided to migrate to Israel. So they are Zionists. And some of them are Muslim that was born in Israel. Israel, but they are not Israel from the seed of Abraham. So now the shaking of Israel is not really because of Israel, but because of the immigrants living in that nation. You need to understand, people, there are personal shakings and there are national shakings, and the personal shaking is order to test your faith. Don't you know that God can bless you on a personal level, and yet all of you are miserable on a national level? You can be blessed with God with a nice score, with a nice house. All your children had finished college. Okay, you wear nice, you smell nice. You have a farmland, you have a thriving business. God bless you on a national level, but still you are miserable on a national level. Every time you hear the news, you are miserable because another wicked person was in a position. And because of this, Singapore is going to arise to become the America of Asia. You are going to see it, that a lot of Americans and Europeans will migrate in Singapore. And think about this, the nation has no natural resources. It has no ocean, it has no river, it has no farmlands, okay? It has no gold, it has no oil, it has no natural gas. She has nothing. She only has one thing, she is very righteous. You see, these people, even though I don't have what you have, if I walk in righteousness, at the end of the day, 50 years later, I am better than you. Singapore has proven it. Philippines, I don't have this, I don't have that. I don't have your mountains, I don't have your oil reserve, I don't have your gold in Mindanao, I don't have your fishes at the ocean, but 50 years later, I am good than you. That is Singapore. You know why? Because when righteousness is abounding in the land, people are doing their business honestly, and a lot of immigrants would like to migrate that nation. And people, get this, if you want to see a nation flourish and prosper, you cannot do it by yourself alone. You need to open up your borders to other foreign immigrants in order to cross-pollinate you with their wisdom, with their money, with their technical skills, with their technological knowledge. Because not Gentile nation is possessed with the level of intelligence in order to grow their economy. Yeah. Have you heard of eBay? On the internet, do you know what is the company that runs the, who will predict that eBay is being hacked by people and would like to deceive you? That's a Jewish company based on Israel. Ramayasikata. For the longest time, the body of Christ do not understand what is the significance of the Jewish people in relationship to cross-pollination of talents, skills, technology, and knowledge, and even intelligence. Why? We are not taught. Because a lot of what enters the body of Christ is what they call replacement theology, that they said that Israel does not exist anymore. They knew it. Israel is in the Middle East. But they thought that the plan of God for Israel does not apply for today. Absolutely wrong. The plan of God for Israel still stays today, but the enemy would like to kill it in what you call an erroneous replacement theology, in order to deceive the church that the plan of God had shifted to the church. The Lord Jesus Christ has a plan for the church. And God the Father, He has also a plan for Israel. And the plan of God for Israel is different from the plan of God for the church. The church will be married to Jesus, but Israel, she will be married to God. That's in the book of Isaiah. Praise the Lord. Point number two, when God determines when a nation is going to stop to exist, we are going to follow this time my numbering here. I prepared this for you. In Revelation chapter 18, verse 21. Look at this in the New Testament. Revelation 18, verse 21. Then a strong angel took up a stone like a great millstone and threw it into the sea, saying, so will Babylon, the great city, be thrown down with violence and will not be found any longer. Do you see that? This is the vision of John the Revelator. A lot of the prophecies of John the Revelator are already happening today. And a lot of prophecies that you will see right now in the Middle East, you are going to see it. They were already prophesied in the book of Isaiah. In the next four sessions of the tears, I am going to tell you where everything is heading in the Middle East. And you are going to see it. Remember that Summit is a national conference. You are going to hear messages on a national level. So stay with me, because you don't hear this a lot in your church services. John the Revelator have seen the angel of the Lord being released to the nation of the world, okay? And the Bible said that the angel has a stone. This is not like a vision of a little kid with a little pebble and you throw it to the river. It's not like that, okay? This is a vision of an angel. I want you to understand that the angel of the Lord is not as big as us. The angel of the Lord is very huge. In the book of Judges chapter 2, when the angel of the Lord manifested to Israel in order to warn Israel of their departure from the covenant of God, you know what the angel of the Lord did? The angel of the Lord stood from one mountain, Bethel, and the other feet was already Gilgal. The angel of the Lord need two cities to accommodate himself because he is so big. Look at me, I am so small. My position, I'm still here in Central Plains. Even though my two legs are here. But the angel of the Lord could not, the entire Central Plains mall could not fit 1 foot of the angel. He needs two cities to stand. 1 foot is in Bethel and the other foot is in Gilgal. Why he is so big and he has a message for the entire nation. God would really like to say to it that you get the message. He did not send an ant. He sent a very huge being, an angel that will occupy two cities so that you will not mistake the angel as a rainbow, as a sun, or a moon, or a star. You will see it is an angel of the Lord. In the Philippines, if something shows up, oh, that's Virgin Mary, apparition. Another there, oh my God, you know. That's why the discernment is so clouded with, there is no sharpness in the understanding of the mystery, because the mind is full of apparitions. We need to deliver you from that. The angel that was mentioned in the book of Revelation, this is a very big angel. And then he grabbed a stone. You know what is funny? It says there's a stone. It's not a little stone. It's not even a stone as big as this. You know what stone is that? Listen to this. It's an asteroid. You need to understand, when the book of Revelation was written, John the Revelator is not like you. You are a graduate of Harvard University. You have a scientific knowledge. You already have the English vocabulary alone is growing 1,000 words every year. Okay? So there are words in the book of Revelation that were not yet created when this was written. But today, the stone has already a name. You call it asteroid. You know what is crazy here? Because it looks like that the asteroid is going to fall before the year ends. At this point of time, United States had not disclosed it to the nations of the world that there is already a detection of NASA. That asteroid is going to hit near the ocean of Puerto Rico. It can happen between September or to the early parts of next year. And the asteroid, hear this, the size of the asteroid is 2.5 kilometers in size. Okay, if this is the beginning of the asteroid, the size in length is 2.5 kilometers. That is the stone that the Bible is talking. If that stone falls into your head, sister, you will never recover. You will see Jesus quick. If that stone falls into your house is gone. The entire Bacolod will disappear, including Negros. That is not a little stone that will create a little Bacolod. You will be gone as a people. You will be gone as a city. You will be gone as a nation. This is what John the Revelator had said. And if the prediction of NASA is correct, this is not my prophecy. This is the prediction of NASA. Okay? That's in United States. They look at and they study the movements of the sun of the planets. And they're also the ones that reported the arrival of the blood moons. When the stone is going to hit, and their projection is going to hit Puerto Rico, that size of an asteroid that big, 2.5 kilometers in length, once it falls into the ocean, it is going to create a huge impact that the water is going to spill over. Now the spillover is what you call tsunami. That tsunami, it is going to cover the entire Puerto Rico. It is going to cover the islands of North America, like Bahamas, like Cayman Islands, like Barbados. Even countries like Jamaica, St. Kitts, they will all be drowning. They will be no more. And part of the United States, 10% of their population, those living in Florida, Washington, D.C., will be killed. The Lord has given me a dream 2 years ago, and I saw in a dream that the Lord brought my spirit in Washington, D.C. While I was there, I was walking, and my kids are with me. And then I saw a huge tsunami rising up. And people are not aware that it is coming because they are doing about their business. They are driving. They are kayaking. They are on their jet ski at the ocean. Okay, it looks like it is going to hit in a very nice day. And then all of a sudden, a huge tsunami like the size of the Indian Ocean tsunami that hits Indonesia 10 years ago, that is like 200 feet, okay, higher than that, hit Washington, D.C. And I told my husband, what is the ocean facing Washington, D.C.? The ocean facing Washington, D.C. is the Atlantic Ocean. The bad news is this. The asteroid that was detected by NASA to fall either from September until early of 2016, it is going to hit the Atlantic Ocean.